Hello friends, now in this session we are going to discuss about the industrial hygiene and occupational health part, that is ventilation and heat stress. So as we know that in industry, in the residential, in the commercial, in any type of activity, we have to take care about the ventilation systems because we need the air to breathe and the amount of air which is sufficient for our breathing, for our comfortability, we have to provide the air in a sufficient amount and in a particular direction also. Also, there is a point that is called as temperature. So normally 20 to 30 degrees Celsius temperature range is the comfortable range for the Indians. And that is why we have to also take care about the temperature which is surrounding us. So there may be a different processes like the heating process, the foundry process, the furnaces, the boiler process, etc., where the temperature is very high as compared to the average or the ambient temperature. And from that point of view, we have to consider, we have to study this ventilation and heat stress. So what is the purpose of ventilations? So the ventilation means the requirement of air in a sufficient amount, and that air should be fresh air. So air is a life and fresh air is the need of survival of living creatures. So absence of air brings death within a few minutes, and life without breathing is not possible, and the clean air is needed for the whole life. So for breathing and functioning of the human body, there is a need of sufficient fresh air, and that is the permanent requirement. So this requirement is called as ventilation, and the good ventilation means sufficient fresh air should be provided. So we can calculate also how much quantity of the fresh air is required for this particular department, for the particular laboratory, for the particular working area, etc. Then human body can't tolerate excessive temperature. So that is another thing. So we know that for the normal or the ambient temperature is 20 to 30. Then only we can feel comfortable and we can work easily at any platform. If the temperature increases, like in summer, our temperature may be 40, 45 plus, then there may be a problem of heat stresses. In some of the cases, there may be a cold stress also. If the temperatures are less than 10 or less than zero also, that is in the negative temperature, then also there is an issue related to the skin or some other body parts, that is called as cold stresses due to lowest temperature or lower temperature. So there may be an issue of heat stresses, there may be an issue of cold stresses, and that is why we have to control this environmental temperature. So for controlling this environmental temperature, some of the activities should be done, and one of the main thing is called as ventilations. So in the ventilation, we are providing the sufficient fresh air, and that is why whatever the temperature, whatever the heat which is gained by that air which is present in that working environment can be flushed off with the help of this fresh air, as fresh air is inserted or entered into that room, then obviously whatever the existed air can be blown off. So ventilation is one of the technique to remove the excessive temperature. And other thing which can increase the temperature is nothing but the carbon dioxide. So in the natural way also, in human beings, there is a respirations. So in the respiration, we are inhaling the oxygen and we are exhaling the carbon dioxide. And carbon dioxide is a
having the characteristics to gain the temperature, to hold the temperature, that is nothing but to hold the heat. So if carbon dioxide is going to hold that heat, obviously the temperature of that working room is again going to increase. That is another thing. So we have to control that carbon dioxide also. So by controlling this CO2, by providing the fresh air, and by controlling the temperature at a normal level, we can have the comfortable working environment in our industry. So to control all these temperature criteria, to provide the fresh air, etc., these are the different purposes of this ventilation. So what is the need of safety? So in safety philosophy, we already discussed about the various parameters and the objectives. Like, think about the safety, what is the need of the safety, where it is required, and where are the types and applications of this safety, etc. And we have also discussed about the protect and serve the mankind, to search, suggest, and apply the safe ways of behavior, safe working conditions, and the safe environment for the safety, health, and welfare of all the peoples. So we have discussed all these things in the safety, health, and environment management topic. And now, why I'm recalling these things? Because the main point from this point of view, from the ventilation and heat stress, is safe environment for SHE and welfare. So from the health point of view, we must have the comfortable working environment and safe environment. And from that point of view, this ventilation and heat stress is important. And what is the physiology of these heat regulations? So basically, first of all, we must know what exactly the physiology is. So it is the science of dealing with functioning of living organisms or their parts. So it is a branch of a science which deals with the functioning of living organisms. So now in our case, in the human beings, there may be cells, tissues, organs of human body. So we have to study this normal functioning of the cells, tissue, organs of human body, and that is human physiology. So science of physiology is related to anatomy. So we have already discussed about this anatomy, anthropometry, etc. So anatomy means that is the study of that body parts. So now in this case, it is related to the structure of cells, tissues, and the organs of the human body. From an anatomical point of view, structure of the body can be classified into systems which have particular functions. So every part of our body have different functions and different structures, and that is why we have to study this physiology. Because lung is functioning in a different way, lung is having the different structures, and they are having the different life as well as their characteristics also. In a similar way, heart is another part, and they are having the different functions and characteristics also. In a similar way, there are variety of body parts or the organs in the human body. So to understand the effect of physical and chemical agents on the body, we need to understand the normal functioning of the organs or the organ systems which these agents targets. So we have to study these different organs, then functioning, then structure, and then characteristics. So the systems of human body are skin, respiratory systems, cardiovascular systems, nervous systems, muscles, liver, kidney, GIT, that is gastrointestinal tract, and ear. So these are the major organs of our human body. The respiratory systems, liver, and GIT defend the ill effects of the toxic substances. So when we are working in the environment where the toxic substances are present, then these respiratory systems, liver, and GIT is going to defend these adverse effects or the negative effects of these toxic substances. So this is about the physiology. Now, when this physiology is related or studied with the heat, or the heat regulation, then it is called as physiology of heat regulation. What does it mean? It means when the temperature is higher, normally 30 degrees Celsius plus, then or less than 10 degrees Celsius or in the negative, then we have to check how exactly these human body parts or the organ is going to defend, or what are the adverse effects of these heat that may be increase in temperature, that may be decrease in temperature on your organs or you, the different parts of your body. So that is the physiology of heat regulation. So from this point of view, the main conclusion of this study is that we have to control the temperature in a comfortable zone. That is the main objective of this study. So what are the thermal environments and its measurements? So temperature is not only one parameter to measure for this comfortability of any human being. So for this purpose, we have to measure the air temperature, we have to measure the mean radiant temperature, we have to measure the air velocity, and we have to measure the humidity. Because just increase in the temperature don't affect very much on our body. But if the humidity is also increased, if the air velocity is very low, and if the radiant temperature is also more and air temperature is also more, then we guaranteed feel uncomfortable in that area, and our productivity, our efficiency of working is obviously going to decrease. So before controlling this temperature, humidity and air movement, it is necessary to measure the adequacy. So subsequent measurement is also necessary for the satisfaction that whether they are properly controlled or not. So we have to control all these parameters, that is air temperature, radiant temperature, air velocity and humidity. So how to measure this temperature? So for temperature measurement, we can go for the dry bulb air temperature, then globe temperature and the air velocity. Then for the humidity measurements also, we can utilize the psychrometers, or we can also use the weight and dry bulb temperatures or the hygrometers. So with the help of this, we can measure the humidity or relative humidity or absolute humidity, etc. So there are hydrographs are also available for the continuous reading of this air humidity. Then air movement and control measurement guidelines are given in the IS 3103. So there is a apparatus that is called as anemometer, that is velometers. It is used to measure the air velocity of the air. So there are two types of anemometers or the velometers. One, it is called as revolving vane type, and second one is called as revolving cup types. So the main purpose is to check or to measure the air velocity. Then what is the indices of the heat stress? So we already discussed about the heat stress. If the temperature is more, obviously the heat is more, and we may feel uncomfortable in that atmosphere. So how to check whether the heat stresses are developed in the human body or not? So for that purpose, there should be some index, and that is called as heat stress index. So it is defined as the relation of the amount of evaporation required as relative to the maximum ability of the average person to perspire. So we know that in the summer days, if the temperature is more than 30 degrees Celsius or 40 degrees Celsius, obviously we feel and our body is going to sweat more than the normal one. So what is mean by that sweating? So sweating means that evaporation of that water from the body. Why it is going to do? Because to cool our body at a normal temperature. So our body is going to work as a heat exchanger. As the temperature surrounding us is more than the body temperature, and that is why we have to evaporate some of the water from our body. And that is the index that is called as heat stress index. So it can be calculated or obtained from the charts also. And and takes into account the clothing and workload also. So there are mainly two indices which gives us the idea regarding the heat stress. So first point is, or the first index is effective temperature. What is effective temperature? It is a sensory scale of warmth derived from the dry bulb and wet bulb temperature and the wear velocity. So DBT, WBT and wear velocity are the parameters which can be measured in terms of ET. So from the standard nomogram also, we can get these values. So it is not a temperature measurable with the instruments. So it is not a thermometer or clinical thermometer or pyrometer, etc. It is a indices or the index which gives us the idea regarding the DBT, WBT and wear velocity. So it is a combined effect because we are going to measure these indices for the heat stresses, not our target. It is not our target to measure the temperature only. Our target is to check whether the heat stresses are developed or not, whether the surrounding temperature, air velocity, etc. are comfortable or not. So for that purpose, we are going to check this effective temperature. So it is an index combining effects on a body temperature, humidity and air movement. So it is equivalent to the comfort a person generally feels in a saturated atmosphere with the same DBT with a specific amount or movement of air. So if air movement is okay, if DBT is the same and if the saturated atmosphere is there, then we feel comfortable. And if the person is not going to feel comfortable, it means there may be change in the dry bulb temperature or in the wet bulb temperature or in the air velocity. So that is the indication. That is why it is called as heat stress indices. So second index is CET, that is corrected effective temperature. So we have discussed about the effective temperature. Now it is corrected effective temperature. So it is modified effective temperature. So it consider also the radiant temperature measured by the globe thermometer instead of dry bulb temperature. Now in this case, what is the correction? We are going to use the globe thermometer because in the globe thermometer, there is a globe and we are measuring the radiant temperature instead of dry bulb temperature. So that is why it is called as modified or corrected effective temperature. So it does not include metabolic heat. So our body heat is not going to measure in this CET. So CLI, that is Central Labor Institute, Bombay, has proposed ET and CET values. So these are the different indices. So for the light workload, the energy expenditure is generally 135 kilocalorie per hour. And the ET or CET is 32 degrees Celsius. So for the light workload, the 32 degrees Celsius is the indices that may be ET or CET for 135 kilocalorie per hour energy expenditure. If the workload is medium, then obviously energy expenditure is more than the light one. So that is near about 225 and the ET or CET is 29.5 degrees Celsius. And for the heavy workload, the energy expenditure is 315 kilocalorie per hour and ET or CET is 29 degree Celsius. So these are the heat stress indices given by the CLI. So in between 29 to 32 degrees Celsius are the ETC, CET or ET values. Then what is the thermal limits for the comfort and good efficiency? So to have the comfortable atmosphere, comfortable environment, and to have the great efficiency, we must measure the different atmospheric conditions. So what are that atmospheric conditions? The conditions are temperature, ventilation, humidity, radiant heat, and greenhouse effect. Because in the greenhouse effect, again, there is a majority of carbon dioxide. Some other greenhouse effects are CCL, 4 or CFCs or oxygen or ozone or water or
other parts like methane, but the majority part is carbon dioxide, which is related to this thermal limits of compound. So we are going to measure all these parameters and the combined effect, then we can consider at what exactly the comfortable zone is. So in Indian atmosphere, 20 to 30 degrees Celsius is the comfortable temperature for variety of workers. And from the American Ventilating Engineering Association, they recommend us the different values for the different places. So the places like lecture hall. So for this lecture hall, 16 to 18 degrees Celsius is the comfortable temperature. Then for the sleeping rooms, 12 to 15 degrees Celsius. For the workshops, 16 to 18 degrees Celsius. And for the vigorous activity in the workshops, 10 to 15 degrees Celsius. For the bedrooms, 20 to 20 degrees Celsius. For the gymnasium, 15.5 degrees Celsius. So these are the different temperature criteria for having the comfortable atmosphere in that working environment. So that is from the American Ventilating Engineering Associations. Then what is the effect of this temperature on our skin? So depending on the temperature range, the different aspects are there or different effects are there. So for example, if the temperature is near about 160 degree Fahrenheit or 180 Fahrenheit or 212 Fahrenheit, then it can cause second degree burn or 60, 30 and 15 second contact respectively. If the temperature is near about 140 degree Fahrenheit, that gives pain due to the tissue damage, and the temperature below 32 degree Fahrenheit also gives pain due to the tissue damage, but now it is cold stress. So that is called as freezing. So if the temperature is below 32 degree Fahrenheit, then also there is a tissue damage issue. And if the temperature is more than 140 degree Fahrenheit, so that is also an issue related to the tissue damage. If the temperature is 120 degree Fahrenheit, then that gives the pain, but the main cause is due to the burning heat. If the temperature is 94 degree Fahrenheit, that gives warm or neutral feeling. So physiological zero, it is called as concept, that is for 94 degree Fahrenheit. If the temperature is between 37 to 54 degree Fahrenheit, so that gives cool effect, and from 32 degree Fahrenheit and below gives the pain due to freezing, we already discussed. So, but temperature alone is not good indicator, because we have indicated the different effects or the adverse effect due to these various temperatures, but only temperature is not the good indicator for the comfortable conditions. So for that purpose, we have also to check the drafts, that is the wind speeds, excessive moistures, undue dryness, and radiant heat. So the combined effect that may have good relevance, and then we can check the comfortable conditions. So the effect of atmospheric conditions on output and accident rate has been demonstrated in a number of studies. The optimum temperature varies with the type of work that is performed and depends on the state of health, age, clothing, diet, ability of the employee to adapt himself and to different climatic conditions. Because the temperature may be the same, but due to the different persons, and due to the different persons, the person's age may be different, their health may be different, their health conditions may be different, the clothing may be different, diet may be different, and their ability to sustain that temperature or to adjust with the surrounding temperature may be different. So we can't say that this much of temperature is the optimum for all persons. So that depends on these types of parameters. Then barometric pressure has little effect, whereas the temperature and humidity have considerable effect on the human behavior. So sometimes if the temperature is more, humidity is also more, then obviously the behavior of that person is going to change. Then there is a concept that is called as ventilation. There are mainly two types of ventilation, that is called as natural ventilation and mechanical ventilations. So under these natural ventilations and especially a general ventilation, there are two types: supply air systems and exhaust systems. And this supply air system has two purposes, that is heating, ventilating, air conditioning for the comfortable environment. And second objective is, or the purpose is, to replace exhausted air from the plant. So sometimes we have to remove the existed air or the exhausted air from that working environment, and sometimes we have to create a comfortable environment. So for that purpose, we have to supply the fresh air into that environment. So supply air system is one of the ventilation system, and second one is exhaust systems. So in the exhaust system, there are two types: general and local exhaust type. So in the general exhaust systems, that is for the controlling and removal of the contaminant by the dilution or the ventilation systems, or also we can use the local exhaust systems. So in natural ventilation, which is induced because of the two reasons, that is outside wind pressure and temperature difference. Because natural means the air is going to flow from particular direction and from one point to another on the basis of pressure difference, on the basis of temperature difference, and on the basis of air velocity. So all these things, all these parameter is going to control by the nature. That is why it is called as natural ventilation. So that is chimney effect or draft. There is a positive pressure on the windward side and negative pressure on the leeward sides. By providing the adequate openings in these pressure areas, natural ventilation can be achieved. In the residential, in the daily life examples also, you can understand this natural ventilation concept. If your room is there, and if on one side there is a door and on the other side there is window, if you open this door and window, obviously this cross ventilation is going to happen, because on one side there is a low pressure area and other side there may be a high pressure area or positive pressure area. So obviously from high pressure to low pressure, so this air is going to move, and that is called as natural ventilation. In a similar way, there are multiple examples of this natural ventilations. From this diagram also you can understand what exactly the natural ventilations. So in this diagram also, why it is indicated by the blue color and red color. So whether it is natural ventilation, whether it is mechanical ventilation, we know that the hot air is having the low density and cold air is having the high density. So this cold air, which is indicated by the blue color at the bottom side, because the density and the gravity is more as compared to the hot air. And obviously the hot air is having the low density, so it is going to flow in upward direction. So it is indicated by the red arrow. So we require these things because the hot air should be removed from this working environment and cold air or the fresh air should be inserted to the working atmosphere. Then and then only this temperature of this working environment in the working conditions is going to decrease or coming to the normal conditions, and then we feel comfortable. So that is the main purpose of this natural ventilation. So these are the different mechanism systems which can be adopted by the various industries. So these are the old versions of these ventilation systems, but still it is existed and utilized by the industries nowadays also. So you can understand this is a pitch roof type ventilation. So here the space is given for the hot air exist, and here the space is given to have the cold air inside from the outside. So cold air is going to flow from outside to inside from this space, and if there is a hot air or the temperature increased in this area, then hot air is going to remove from this space which is provided at the roof. So there are other types also. So in this case, monitor roof type, that is called as cross ventilations. So there is no space at the top roof, only cross ventilation. So cold air is going to flow from this side, and that may carry the hot air and coming from this other side or vice versa. In a similar way, in this picture also, this is called as repetitive monitor roof, and this is sawtooth roof. So it is famous one. So from this side, the cold air inlet is provided, and here the hot air outlet is provided, or vice versa. So depending on the air direction, low pressure area, high pressure area, or low temperature and high temperature area. Now in this picture also, there is some modification in the basic designs. So now in this case, you can understand this is the vent coming from outside to inside, and some of the air molecules are going to flow from this top. So this is the another vent which is passing over roof. So whatever the hot air is coming from this roof, that can be carried by this outside vent, right? And this cold air is going to inserted into this working environment. So cross ventilation as well as roof ventilation, as well as this pitch roof type of ventilation, all these combinations are given in this example. Now this is another example where you can understand this is the modified sawtooth roof, but now here the specific example of hot surface or the hot process is there. This is the cross ventilations, and these are the specific design spaces which are available. Now here in this case, cross ventilation is not going to happen. So only cold air is going to provide from the bottom side, and whatever the hot air which is surrounded to this hot process or the hot substance is going to pass from this top roof, not the cross type. Then in this case, you can understand this hot air is going to pass from this sawtooth type. And in this case also, there is a specific design, that is modification in the sawtooth creators. And in this design, that is the modified monitor roof. So these are the monitors, that is the basic design. Now this is the modified one. So here rooftop is packed, but now in this case, there is a provision to remove this hot air from the top side. And in this other type also, there is a provision to take the cold air from the outside at the top side itself. And again, cross ventilation as well as cross ventilation at the bottom side, as well as cross ventilation on the top side. So these are the different ventilation systems, especially I'm talking about the natural ventilation. So this is the latest technique nowadays we are using, but this was the old version, but nowadays we are calling it as a turbine. So this rotating cowl requires a lubricant reservoir for its long service to run without the jamming. So this is the old version. Nowadays, whatever the rotating cowl we are using, that doesn't require the lubrications also. So we are using the materials in such a way that there is no need of lubrications. So due to this hot air movement and outside cold air movement or outside hot air movement, this turbine is going to rotate. And due to this rotation, from the inside, the hot air is going to have the area where in the atmosphere this hot air is going to move, and from the bottom side the cold air can be inserted. So automatically this cold air is moved from bottom to top, and hot air is moving from the upward direction, and then it is going outside to the atmosphere. So this is the rotatory, that is why it is called as rotating cowl. Then the second main type is mechanical ventilations. So obviously mechanical ventilation requires some additional facility. It is not a natural ventilation. In the mechanical way, we have to ventilate, we have to supply the air. So that may be employed for the building, that is workroom, and also for the removal of the contaminants. So depending on the requirement, we have to provide this mechanical ventilations. So mechanical means what? Third agency or external agency is incorporated for the ventilation purpose. So sometimes we are using the fans, sometimes we are using the exhaust fan, and sometimes we are using the blowers. So external agency is added for the ventilation purpose. That is why it is called as mechanical ventilations. So there may be a negative ventilation, that is also called as exhaust ventilations. So we know that a negative pressure, and from that negative pressure, this is the negative ventilations. So in this negative ventilation, we have to avoid the short circuits, that is short circulating of air. And we have to calculate the area also, because the total inlet area should be at least 3 times the total disc area of the fan. As we are using the fan for this mechanical ventilations, for the negative ventilations or the exhaust ventilation. So this is the thumb rule that total inlet area should be at least 3 times the total disc area of the fan. So exhaust fan should have windshields on the outside of the wall so that the wind pressure may not decrease their efficiency. The fan discharge should be diverted into the large ducts, carried vertically upwards with the rainwater cap at the top, and fans should have proper guarding or fencings. So this is the one of the example of this negative ventilation or the exhaust fan. So this fan is installed here, and due to this fan pressure, this negative pressure is created, and due to this vacuum is created, and the surrounding air near to this fan is going to suck, and then this air is going to force outside to outside the working environment and towards the atmosphere. And then in this diagram also you can understand, this is the hot air which is present in this area. Now due to this fan or exhaust fan, whatever the hot air is present or the mixture of air is present, it is sucked by this fan and it is sent to the top of the roof. In this diagram also you can understand, from various points you can suck or absorb this hot air or the mixed air, and that can be provided to the exhaust fan assembly or the exhaust fan room, and from that point of view they can send to the top of the roof. So you can use the multiple point absorber also, or you can also use the combination of this negative and positive pressure also. Then the next one is positive ventilation, that is plenum ventilations. So for the large workroom, it is required. So exhaust ventilation or negative ventilation can be utilized for the small workroom or the small spaces where the volume of the air is very less. But for the larger workrooms, we have to provide the positive ventilations. And for the volume of air, there is a simple formula that is called as Q is equal to AV. So Q is the air volume in meter cube per minute. A is the area, that is free area of intake openings of ducts in meter square. And capital V is the average velocity of air in meter per minute. So this meter square into meter per minute, that gives meter cube per minute. So we can calculate the volume of air with the help of this formula. And depending on this formula or depending on this volume, we have to provide the fan with that particular capacity. So the positive air pressure inside the room disallows outside hot or cold air leakage inside. The duct should be smooth, straight with minimum bends and without sudden enlargement or contraction. Otherwise, the efficiency of this fan is going to decrease. then air velocity in that should be 10 meter per second for the gases and 20 meter per second for the particulates. So air velocity should be like 10 meter per second or 20 meter per second. Then there is a next concept, whatever we called it as AC, that is called as air conditioning. So normally people are thinking this AC means air cooling, but it is not the case. Because in India, it is okay that we are having the average temperature more than 20 in all the atmosphere, in all the weather conditions. But in cold countries, the temperature may be in minus also. So from that point of view, we can understand what exactly the AC is, that is air conditioning. So in a very cold country, room air heating is also air conditioning. So we are going to control this air temperature, that is comfortable temperature. That is why it is called as air conditioning. So air cooling may be required in the summer season in India, but air heating may be required in the cold countries. So both the examples are related to the air conditioning only. So its prime purpose is to keep air in the condition comfortable to the man. Air conditioning means conditioning the air for maintaining the specific conditions of temperature, humidity, air circulation, and dust level inside an enclosed space or room. So the conditions to be maintained are dictated by the need for which the space is intended for, and air condition is designed for the human beings. It is called comfort conditioning. And that is why nowadays, if you observe in the multinational companies' offices, in the IT offices, everywhere these ACs are installed. Because depending on our requirement, we can utilize or use this AC for as an air heater or air cooler. But when it is designed to preserve things at low temperature, it is called as refrigeration. So sometimes if you required the temperature lower than the normal one, then it is called as refrigeration. So there are different naming: air cooling, air heating, refrigerations. But all these things can be done with the help of AC only, that is air conditioning. So this air conditioning process are cooling only, that is without humidification, maybe cooling and dehumidification, maybe cooling and or heating, and fin cooling coils with direct expansion, or cooling with humidification, and desert coolers. So these are the various AC processes. Now, how to control this heat exposure at source? Sometimes it is the case that we can't remove that air or the hot air. We can't control that temperature in that specific process. And then we have to control this heat exposure. Because in, for example, in some of the industries, if you are using the boiler, then we have to use the furnace. If you are using the furnace, obviously the temperature surrounding the furnace is more than the surrounding of other average temperature. If you are using the steel industry operations, if you are using the foundry operations, if you are using the heat exchangers or the heaters, then obviously the temperature of the surrounding air is more than the average. So in that cases, we have to control this heat exposure. So how to control that heat exposure at source? The method is isolation or the segregation. So the first step obviously is to isolate the heat source wherever possible or to segregate them. Means we have to keep the distance so that we can't feel the higher temperature on our body. The location of the furnace in separate wings rather than in a large single building will simplify the problem of supplying air from the general ventilation. And that is why you can observe the furnaces or the boiler rooms are isolated from the other building or the other process rooms. These wings may have high roof to provide a better chimney effect for the removal of hot air over the furnaces. So provide engineering controls for the general air movement, shielding of radiant heat sources, and to reduce the process heat, water vapor release and the metabolic rate. So all these things are under the engineering control. So we have to control this air movement, we can control this radiant heat, we can control this process heat or water vapor with the help of some engineering control. So we have to control the temperature, we have to control the pressure, we have to control some of the flow rate, etc. And then we can also control the metabolic rate also. So these are some of the techniques to control the heat exposure at source with the help of isolation or segregation. Then there is another method to control this heat exposure, that is called as dilution and also a local ventilation. So what is dilution? It is helpful in reducing contaminant concentration in work area. So to control health and fire hazards. So what is contamination? Simple example, if the 3 ppm parts of a toxic substance is present in that working environment in the 1 meter cube of air. So 3 ppm is the 3 parts per million. But if you are considering 3 parts per 1 meter cube of air, then the concentration of that particular substance in that area is 3 parts or the milligrams per meter cube. And if we are providing the excess air, and if that 1 meter cube is going to increase by 1 meter cube again, then that concentration becomes 3 milligram per 2 liters or the 2 meter cube of air. Now this 1 meter cube denominator side is changed as 2 meter cube. Obviously denominator side is increased. It means the ratio is going to decrease. It means the concentration is going to decrease, and that is called as dilution. So we are going to dilute that concentration by supplying the excess air. That is the basic concept. So this is useful to control the less toxic vapors such as from the organic solvents, and it is not useful to control the fumes, dust, contaminants of high toxicity. So if the threshold value is less than the 100 ppm, then only it is useful. Otherwise, we have to go for other methods for controlling these heat exposures. So high quantity or the concentration can be controlled by other methods, but if the concentration is low, then we can dilute that concentration, we can dilute that heat exposure with the help of excess fresh air supply. So it is also not useful where pollutants are released intermittently. So sometimes if the frequency is different and if the pollutants are released intermittently, means in between, then we can't use these dilution methods. Then we can go for the LEV, that is local exhaust ventilation systems. It is nothing but the extract ventilation systems. So where these dust, gases, fumes are there and which is not controlled by the dilution method, now which can be controlled by these LEV systems. So you can also observe these LEV systems nowadays in the new flats, also in the kitchen itself. So in the kitchen itself, we are using the local exhaust ventilation systems for removing the fumes which can be created while making or preparing some foods. So if the threshold limit value is more than 100 ppm, then we can prefer the LEV. Now where the emissions of heat or contaminants are high, dilution ventilation is not fully effective, and that is why we should go for the LEV. So exhausted air may be recirculated after cleaning and filtering to increase the rate of mechanical ventilations. So this is the LEV. Previous one is dilution, and then the local source or the isolation systems or the segregation systems. So these are the different methods which can be used to control the heat exposure at the source itself. Now, what are the recommended values for these air changes? Because we know that ventilation is good. We know that we have to open the windows, we have to open the doors, we should use the fans or the blowers or the ACs, etc. But what exactly the values are there? Is there any rules and regulation? Yes. So Factory Act 1948 is the legal provision or the act where you can understand the different recommended values. So Section 13 of Factory Act 1948 is given. So in this Section 13 of the Factory Act, which requires effective, suitable, adequate ventilation in every factory. So in this section, it is clearly mentioned that effective, suitable, and adequate ventilation. So what is meant by adequate again? We can calculate the volume of air, we can calculate the fresh air supply, we can calculate the circulation of that fresh air, we can measure the temperature, we can measure the radiant temperature, etc. So all these things indirectly given into the Section 13. So to provide the comfort and prevent the health injuries to the workers, it also requires well-designed walls, roofs, insulations of hot parts to reduce the excessive temperature. Then Section 40 of this Factory Act requires local exhaust ventilation. So LEV requirement is there clearly mentioned for the dust, fumes, and other impurities with the enclosure on such source to prevent the inhalation and accumulation in the workroom. Then Section 15 is related to the artificial humidifications. And rule number 19 to 29 of Gujarat Factory Rule prescribe the dry and well-termed temperatures. So humidity, relative humidity, absolute humidity, and their measurement devices, their comfortable zone, etc. is given in the Section 15. So if the humidity is reduces due to some processes, then obviously you can humidify that working environment with the help of artificial humidification. Then Section 16 requires, calls for a minimum 14.2 meter of breathing space per worker. So this 14.2 meter square of breathing space is clearly mentioned for a single worker. So depending on the number of workers, we have to calculate the area. Then Section 36 and 37 prescribe for venting dangerous gases from a confined space and safety measures, including the work permit, self-breathing apparatus, safety belt before allowing entry to such confined spaces. So these are the different provisions in terms of sections of Factory Act 1948, which gives us the idea regarding the requirement of ventilations with reference to the legal requirement. So this is the idea related to this LEV. Receptor hood, so at the source itself, you can absorb these fumes or dust or whatever the contamination that is toxic substances. So more than 100 ppm toxic substances are present, then we have to use this LEV systems. So this is another systems from the working environment. You can absorb these gases, and then with the help of fan and cyclone separator, we can provide the clean air to the atmosphere or in the working conditions. Then there is a standard also recommended for these various areas. So for the air changes, we have already discussed about the Factory Act and their respective sections. Now there are national standards like 3103, 3362, 12332, then 3768, 12814, 3271, 3828, etc. So all these standards you can refer for a specific purpose. For example, if you want to use the rotating cowl for the ventilation purpose, then you have to refer this 3271 standard. If you want to use the frame steamer, then 4021. If you want to use the mechanical refrigeration systems, then you can use the another standard. So likewise, you can refer these different national standard for the ventilation purpose. Thank you.